In the last video, we familiarized ourselves with Rn. But as of now, this Rn is just a set. It just contains some elements. But we can use the extra structure of real numbers, basically that we can add to real numbers and multiply to real numbers to give some extra structure for Rn. For instance, if you have two elements, say x1, x2, etc. up to xn, and y1, y2, etc. up to yn, then we can add these two elements. What is the sum of those two elements? You just do coordinate-wise addition. That means we take x1 plus y1, x2 plus y2, comma, etc. up to xn plus yn. And this we treat as the sum of the two elements, x1, x2, etc. up to xn, and y1, y2, etc. up to yn. Now, we cannot multiply two elements in Rn, but we can multiply an element of Rn by an element in R. More precisely, we can look at the quantity alpha times x1, x2, etc. up to xn, and that is defined to be equal to alpha times x1, alpha times x2, etc. up to alpha times xn. So in this way, we can add two elements that belong to Rn, and we can multiply an element in Rn by an element in R. This is called scalar multiplication. So we can add two elements and we can do scalar multiplication. And this gives a rich structure to the space Rn. Let us try to understand this better using an example. Of course, we will just do one example, and you are encouraged to play with many more examples. So let us take n equal to 2, that is, let us look at the space R2, and let us consider two elements in this space R2, namely the elements 1, 2 and the element 5, 3. So how would you add these two elements? You add these to get 1 plus 5, 2 plus 3. Which is equal to 6, 5. So this is the addition of the two elements 1, 2 and 5, 3. Now let us multiply the element 5, 3 with a number, say square root of 2. When you multiply, you will get 5 root 2, 3 root 2. And this way you play with many more examples and try to get a better understanding of this concept.
We will not deal with more examples right now, but instead we will look at some properties of these operations.
First, we will look at some properties of vector addition. Consider the sum x1, x2, x3, etc. up to xn plus y1, y2, y3, etc. up to yn. This sum is equal to x1 plus y1, x2 plus y2, etc. up to xn plus yn. But we know that x1 plus y1 is equal to y1 plus x1. Why? Because addition of real numbers is commutative. Similarly, x2 plus y2 is equal to y2 plus x2. And so on, xn plus yn is equal to yn plus xn. But this sum is equal to y1, y2, etc. up to yn plus x1, x2, etc. up to xn. So we can see that commutativity of real number addition gave us commutativity of vector addition. Similarly, we can prove that associativity of real number addition gives you associativity of vector addition. More precisely, x1, x2, etc. up to xn plus y1, etc. up to yn plus z1, etc. up to zn is equal to x1, etc. up to xn plus y1 etc. up to yn plus z1 etc. up to zn.
We know that 0 had a special role in the study of addition of real numbers, and similarly, the element in Rn with all its entries 0 has a special role in the study of R. Namely, if you add this to any other element x1, x2, x3, etc. up to xn, then you get x1, x2, x3, etc. up to xn. This special vector will be called the zero vector. Also, if you take any element x1, x2, x3, etc. up to xn, you can look at minus x1, minus x2, etc. up to minus xn. And the sum of these two will give you the zero vector. More precisely, given any vector, it has an inverse. So in some sense, vector addition does not behave too differently from real number addition. Similarly, we can prove some nice properties of scalar multiplication. To begin with, we can show that scalar multiplication behaves well with multiplication of real numbers. More precisely, if you scale a vector with the product of two real numbers, you get what you will get if you first scale with beta and then you scale with alpha. Similarly, we knew that 1 was a special number when it comes to multiplication of real numbers, and that speciality holds even when we consider scalar multiplication. Finally, scalar multiplication distributes over vector addition and over field addition. I know I went over these properties quite quickly, but that is because I expect you to have seen these properties before. These are properties of a vector space, and I'm sure you have seen it when you studied linear algebra. And the fact that Rn satisfies these properties make Rn a vector space. So I did not want to spend too much time on these properties, but I wanted to quickly revise these ideas so that they are fresh in your mind. And I want to emphasize that we call addition of two elements in Rn vector addition because Rn is a vector space. So in hindsight, it all makes sense. So for us, in a sense, a vector is nothing but a point in Rn. For simplicity, I am going to just draw a point in R2. But in physics and maybe in other subjects, you might have often thought or seen vectors represented as an arrow which has a length and a direction. So how are these two notions related to each other? That's something we need to understand. So, given a point in R2, what we can do is we can consider an arrow that starts from 0 and ends at this point. And this is the arrow associated to that point. So, that is how we relate points in a vector space and arrows. And hopefully, you might have seen how this enables us to give a geometric representation of vector addition. More precisely, if we are given two vectors, we can draw parallel vectors and complete that to form a parallelogram. Once we get a parallelogram, the diagonal of that parallelogram represents the sum of these two vectors. Of course, my drawing is not great and this does not really look like a parallelogram, but I hope you get the picture. Similarly, you might have also seen that if you have a vector and you multiply it by a scalar, what you end up getting is a scaled copy of the same vector. If the scalar is positive and has a magnitude that is greater than 1, you will get something like the red arrow. Otherwise, you will get something like the yellow arrow. On the other hand, if the scalar is negative, then you will get something like the green arrow. Finally, if we want to draw a vector at an arbitrary point, then we can make use of the parallelogram representation. Notice that in this diagram, if this was A and this was B, then this diagonal was A plus B. Now notice that if you started from the point B and drew a vector A from B, then it will end at the point A plus B. In other words, if you want to draw a vector A starting from the point B, then we first mark the point A plus B and then draw an arrow starting from B and ending at A plus B. So this is the way we draw an arbitrary vector starting at an arbitrary point. This also tells you how two different points P and Q determine a vector. Given two points P and Q, it determines a vector P minus Q. What is P minus Q? If suppose P is the point x1, x2, x3, etc. up to xn and Q is the point y1, y2, etc. up to yn, then P minus Q is nothing but coordinate wise subtraction, which is x1 minus y1, x2 minus y2, etc. up to xn minus yn. And with this, I have covered all I wanted to talk about the vector space structure of Rn and vectors. I know I have gone through it quite quickly, but that is because this is only meant as a review. However, if you have any queries, let me know and I would be more than happy to clarify them.